We are now going to hear from Alexandra, who is in Egypt. She's going to tell us about her life with Aniridia and her career in education. Please take it away, Alexandra. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for listening to my talk about Aniridia. So, first of all, my name is Alexandra. I'm half Greek, half French, and I was born and raised in Egypt. I am 26 years old. I was born with congenital aniridia, and I have sporadic aniridia, so it means that I am the first person in my family to have aniridia. The reason why I chose to this talk today is to talk to you about my life with aniridia, my different experiences, how I felt when my vision was stable and when it wasn't, and my professional experiences as a disabled person. And how I dealt with all of this different situations. First, I want to say that I hope this talk will help parents of children with aniridia who are concerned about the future of their child. And I want to tell them that participating in this webinar is already a great step for understanding and helping their children. And also I want to tell them that even if you have aniridia, you can still achieve a lot in life. I also hope that by sharing my experience and some advices that I learned through the years, I can help other people who have aniridia. I hope that this talk can also help researchers and ophthalmologists and also any other person interested to know about aniridia. And finally, I would like to thank all the people who participated in the preparation of this webinar. Now, let me start from the beginning. So as I said, I was born in Egypt, and my parents had no idea that aniridia existed when I was born. So at the hospital where I was born in Alexandria, it's a city in Egypt, no one detected the disease. And it took my parents a few months to realize that they had a visual handicap. As most parents of aniridia children know, they realized this due to the fact that my eyes always looked tired and moved a lot. My mom went to my pediatrician who examined me after I was born. My mom told her that she thinks something was wrong with my vision. So my pediatrician thought maybe I was blind, and she did the test to see if I could follow the movement of objects with my eyes. Since my eyes were moving with the object's direction, she said that I was not blind and that nothing was wrong. I mean, she thought I had ordinary eyes. Of course, this pediatrician did not know that aniridia even existed, so how could she have thought to check for it? After 7 months, my mom still thought that something was wrong. So she decided to take me to a different doctor. This was the first time that she realizes I had aniridia and that she even knows that there was a rare disease called aniridia. Okay. This doctor advised her to go see a specialist outside of Egypt, as he said there were no competent doctors that would know enough about this condition in Egypt. At this time, my mom took me to Switzerland at the official hospital Jules Gonin, in the city of Lausanne. The doctors who examined me there confirmed that I had aniridia, and also I was diagnosed with a convergent strabismus in the right eye. Strabismus, for people who don't know what it is, it's when your eyes turn inwards toward your nose. And I also had nystagmus. I still have today like a nystagmus, but on usually weak frequency. Interestingly, also today, I have convergent strabismus, but in the left eye, not so much in the right eye. In 1993, I was 1 year old, and I did my first surgery in my left eye because I had a very high eye pressure of 32, although I was under synoptic eye drops. The surgery I did in 1993, it was called cyclocricocoagulation. And from 1993 to 1998, I had a stable left eye pressure, so it was between 10 and 12. In my right eye, I was using Vitoptic eye drops twice per day, but my pressure was around 20, so it was still a bit high. Until 1998, where my eye pressure started to increase again, and it reached really high levels. So I had the very high glaucoma. In my right eye, it had reached 48, and in the left eye, it had reached 28. And so the doctor decided to operate right away in Switzerland, and they did a viscocanalostomy. So this surgery was done by Dr. André Mermoz. And Dr. André Mermoz is a specialist of glaucoma. He has been my main doctor during all the past years, and he is very good, I think. I want to stop here just for a second and say that I tried to read through all my previous medical reports to do a summary of the information, but of course it feels a bit like reconstructing pieces of a puzzle, because I have a long medical record and spread across different clinics and doctors. So I want to advise people with aneurysma to have a notebook to keep records of their medical visits, and so that they can, for example, write their air pressure every time they go to the doctor, the percentage of vision, etc. I think this can help them to monitor their sight and keep track of any major changes. And I haven't done that, so I know I have to start doing that also. I think having a file of all your medical documentation is very important, especially when you have aneurysma. And also especially if you don't live in the country where you do your main medical visits. A country such as Egypt, where ophthalmologists don't know much about aneurysma. It can be a very complicated situation for these people, because they tend to have medical records in different clinics and hospitals, and sometimes in different languages. So going back to the surgery that I did in 1998, it was called a visco canalostomy. And the surgery, I think it was successful at some point, because I spent the following 19 years of my life with a stable eye pressure. So from 1998 until 2017, I wasn't taking any specific treatment for aneurysma, and my eye pressure was stable. I would go like every 6 months only to check my eye pressure, which would be around 10 to 15. I was not using any drugs except for artificial tear drops occasionally. And I traveled once per year to do a checkup with my doctor in Switzerland, Dr. André Marmont. First, I am happy to have, I'm lucky, I mean, to have a French passport, and that my family had the means to travel abroad, which is not the case for anyone with aneurysma. And when Dr. Mermoz left Hospital Jules Gonin and opened his own clinic, I followed him and did my checkups at Clinique Montchoisi, because I really value his opinion. Thanks to his intervention in 1998, I had no major medical problems. From 1998 to 2017, my vision was decent, and I managed to go to school, university, and do a master's degree with very little accommodation. I was allowed 1/3 extra time for exams and to submit assignments, which I sometimes used and sometimes not. Except for that, I did not need any specific accommodation. During this period, I could still feel, however, that my vision was very slowly decreasing. So I started to wear glasses only when I was in university, actually. And my glasses made up for that sight loss. I could also feel that I was becoming more sensitive to sunlight. And during one of my visits to Dr. André Mermoz in Switzerland, maybe 3 or 4 years ago, I am not sure, because I did not keep a record. He told me that I had a beginning of cataract, that will require surgery in the future. But although my visual capacity was slowly getting worse, I lived 19 years of my life in peace. And I could spend days and weeks not thinking about aneurysm because I was not taking treatment and doing checkups only twice a year. However, the past year and a half, since the beginning of 2017, my left eye has been itching a lot, and its vision became blurrier. So I went to see many different doctors in Egypt to understand why I was feeling uncomfortable. They all said that I had conjunctivitis, so like an sort of eye allergy where the eye becomes red and very dry and sticky. And they gave me treatment for it. I would use the treatment and feel better for a few days, but then the itching and uncomfortable feeling would start again. So I would go to a different doctor who would also give me a different treatment. And I used many different eye drops at that time, and I did not keep track of them. I also did not know until very recently that eye drops with preservatives could be harmful for aneurysmal eyes. Maybe some of them had preservatives, but I am not sure. After 3 months of field trials, I went to Switzerland again to visit Dr. Henri Mermoud. That was in March 2017. He said I had a conjunctivitis also, and he gave me a treatment. When we went to the pharmacy to get the treatment, the drops were not available in any pharmacy. So that reminds me to tell to parents and patients of aneurysm that you should always double check if the treatment that your doctor prescribes is available at the pharmacy, because sometimes it can be very tricky to find the treatment that you need. We went back to the clinic and they prescribed another eye drop. During this visit in Switzerland, they also advised me to start wearing contact lenses, and I did not know at that time that contact lenses could be harmful for aneurysmal eyes. These contact lenses were for light protection, not for improvement of the vision. And they took a few months to be ready, as they had to be customized for my eyes. So I started to wear them in the summer of 2017. But I couldn't stand to wear them for more than a few hours as my vision would start to be blurry and it was uncomfortable. It was also very difficult for me to put them on my own as I could not see the right side from where they should be placed. You know, like for me, both sides, they look pretty much the same. I did not wear them a lot, so maybe just a week or so, and then I stopped. By the beginning of 2018, so the beginning of this year, my left eye was itching again, but much more frequently. And my vision in the left eye was becoming also blurrier. So my parents and I came to the realization that something more serious than just a conjunctivitis must be happening with my left eye. Between February and March, I started to check my eye pressure weekly and noticed that it was progressively decreasing. By March 2018, my eye pressure in the left eye was 5, which is very low. So this I learned, it's called hypotonia, when your eye pressure becomes very low. I traveled again to Switzerland in March to visit Dr. Henri Mermoud. By the time I was in his clinic, my eye pressure was 3. It was really, really low. And he decided to operate the next day. The medical report that I got for the surgery does not contain a name for the surgery, and it is too complex for me to explain, but I can share this report with anyone who is interested, or any other report for that matter. But I can try to briefly describe the surgery. I had an ischemic bleb. I'm not sure how ischemic is pronounced, but it means that there is a restriction in the blood supply to the tissues. So the surgery consisted in opening the conjunctiva and removing the ischemic part of it and then reconstructing the sclera. Of course, a lot of these words I don't really understand them myself, but this was it.
Alexander's connection seems to have gone bad. Just give her a few seconds.
So I will continue then. I think I stopped when I was saying that it was very lucky that I discovered Aneurysmal Europe and all the other Facebook groups dedicated to Aniridia, to my mom who looked for it. And so this is through the discovery that we met Galina Gering, who I'm very thankful for also, because she's the one who was able to refer to me this doctor who I went to check with in Germany. He's a specialist of aniridia called Professor Arne Weissen. So I went to his clinic on 18 May 2018, and my pressure was 6 at the time. I was diagnosed with a choroidal swelling. A choroidal is like one of the eye organs, and it was swelling. And also they said that they had the suspicion of a body cleft in the superior part of the eye. And I was prescribed a treatment that I've been using for the past month. It was called Atropine, 0.5 eye drops once per day. And I am supposed to be using it for 6 weeks. I also want to say that also when I was prescribed this treatment, we went to the pharmacy and the treatment was not available. So again, I want to remind people always that you have to make sure right after you leave the hospital that you go to the first pharmacy and try to find it, and if it's not, you can go back right away to the hospital and ask for another treatment. Or sometimes they can have the treatment in the facility. So today, it has been almost a month that I started this treatment. And my eye pressure, the last time I checked 2 weeks ago, was 11. So my eye pressure increased, which is good. My vision is still a bit blurry with the left eye. Some days are better than others. Some times of the day can be actually better than others. I'm not sure if I will ever recover my vision in my left eye, like the way it was before the surgery. But I can only hope that the treatment will keep my eye pressure stable. And apart from the treatment, I also use eye drops, which are like the artificial tears to hydrate the eye. And I'm recommended to use them 5 times per day, which I do. And I also use sometimes at night Bepanthen eye cream. Bepanthen eye cream, I put it at night because if you don't put it at night, it makes your vision really blurry. But I don't know if it really does me any good, I'm not sure. I don't know how my vision is going to develop in the future. But the one thing I am sure about is that this was a wake-up call for me this last year, and that I really have to be more cautious to preserve my vision from now on, much more than I ever was before. Yeah, I really know today that it's important to take care of my eyes, whereas before I was kind of taking my visual stability for granted. It also introduced me to new people through the aniridia Facebook groups. So I'm thankful for that. Like, it's actually the silver lining of all the problems I've had in the past month. The sight loss and surgery I went through since the beginning of the year were very hard for me, especially because it coincided with the moment I had just started my current job. I work as a consultant in a development consultancy firm in Cairo, and I do love my workplace. I was very afraid of my job if I went on a long sick leave just 2 months after I had started, and that I was still on my probation period. But before I tell you more about my current job, I would like to go back to my first professional experiences. And so far, I did 2 internships, and I had 1 job before this one. In all my professional experiences, I always told my employers about my visual handicap. Firstly, because I want them to know that I might need some accommodation if I do. And also because I know that they are legally obliged to hire me even if I have a handicap. So I completed my studies in 2016, and I got my first internship at UNESCO in Paris, where I worked 4 or 5 months. And then I got a second internship in an NGO in Geneva, where I worked for 4 months. During my internships, I did not need any specific type of accommodation to do my work, as the tasks I would do during my internships were individual, in nature and easy for me to understand without requiring help or assistance from anyone. So they were manageable without accommodation, and I asked very limited help from others. However, the situation was more complicated when I got my first job in April 2017. My first job was in the country of Sudan, in the city of the capital city of Sudan, which is Khartoum. And I worked in an American consulting firm at the time. This company was very young. They had just started in 2006. And all of their employees, were also very young people. So including the top management, they were all under 40 years old. And I was the first disabled person to work in this office. So they were not used to that. The workload was also very, very, very heavy. And many tasks were new for me. I needed help from my colleagues to understand how to do that. However, no one had the time to share information because they were all the time very busy with their own workload. And they also didn't really have this culture organization of sharing knowledge. And the people that I had to close working with in the same projects were not also very helpful. So a few weeks after I started, my manager called me in his office and he wanted to talk to me about my handicap. But he was very uncomfortable and he didn't know what words to use, you know? Like I could feel he was embarrassed to use words like disease or handicap. And he asked me if I would like to have a computer screen bigger than the one I had. So to change computers for a bigger one with a bigger screen. I told him that no, because what matters for me is not the size of the screen, but rather the size of the font. But actually, if I could ask him something, it would be to tell my colleagues that I cannot share a screen with someone. Because when they try to show me something on their computer, I cannot see it. I need to use my individual screen and to adjust it with the font I need. I had already told this to some of my colleagues before, but they would just repeat the same thing. My manager said, okay, he would do it. Well, he didn't. And I realized it because a few days later, one of my colleagues was showing me a command to use on a statistical software. And it was written very small, so I asked her to wait till I opened the software and typed the command. And she gave me a very exasperated look, like I was wasting her time. And this is the sort of attitude that can really make you leave your workplace. So during that period, although I'm a relatively relaxed person, I was very stressed during my first job. And I was not able to perform well due to my constant anxiety. So after 6 weeks, my manager called me in his office again, but this time he called me in his office to fire me. He said it was because I did not perform well. And he gave me some, I think, excuses like that my writing skills were not good. So the day after, I was really angry, and I had a lot of things that I wanted to get out of my heart, so I went and I talked to him. I asked him for a meeting the next day, and I told him that I had noticed how uncomfortable he was the day he fired me. He asked me to talk about vision handicap, and also that the one accommodation I asked him to implement, he didn't implement. To which he replied, yes, can you remind me again what that was? So he really didn't remember what it was. I also told him that it's very important that if he has employees with a disability, he should make sure that the accommodations are being implemented. And I honestly think he felt bad that day because he apologized to me after our conversation. And he called me again that day to apologize. I'm not sure what he was trying to apologize about, but what's important for me is that I think he will not do the same mistakes again.
So we need to start wrapping up, Alexander. Someone did ask on the chat, how did you go about finding the internships?
For my university, so first one, I got my internship from my advisor, academic advisor. She sent an email to some of the people at UNESCO and asked and got me the internship. The second internship I got, the founder of the NGO, he did the lecture, so after the lecture I went and I asked him for an internship myself.
So is there anything else you want to say just to wrap up?
The last thing I just want to say is that like now my workplace is very understanding of my handicap, and again, I want to tell people who choose to work in a place like that, if they don't feel comfortable in the workplace, that people are not responsible and understanding, they not stay in this place. Better to work in an environment and company who has experience and has already had like disabled employees such as mine. They already have like 9 people working for them. So I think this is an advantage. Like that's the final thing I would say.
That's good to hear. Have you actually met anyone with any of you in person?
No.
Are you hoping to? When do you think you might do at some point?
Yeah, I'm going to the Aneurysia conference in Paris in August.
Excellent. I'll see you there then.
Yeah, okay, great. Yeah, I look forward to that. Yeah.
So I want to thank you very, very much for that excellent talk. Thank really you. Interesting to hear about people's different experiences in other countries, sort of under different laws and things. So, yeah, thank you once again, Alexandra. Speak to you soon.
Thank you.